Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Welcome to Rolling Attentions. My name is Jason. Today, I'm interviewing two interesting individuals, William Duryea and Rudy Johnson.
Hey. So.
All right.
Hey, how's it going?
Happy to be here.
All right, great. That's good news. So, you guys got a collection of games, not just one. You guys are want to talk about it. The Misery Index, is that the...
Yep, that's the title of the collection. We've been periodically releasing alpha drafts of our games over the course of the last year and a half or so on our website, which is miserytourism.com, under the moniker Misery Tourism Games. So I guess the next natural step was to call our print collection the Misery Index.
Oh, okay, have you guys, other than the alpha releases, have you guys released anything else prior to this, or is this your first big project?
This is our first big project.
Oh, that's really cool. All right. We are basically like a role-playing podcast, so I'm going to have to ask the standard first question as I ask everybody. For both of you, what are your role-playing histories? Like, where did you start from, and, where are you to now with regards to what games you've played?
Sure. I started... My history with role-playing games goes all the way back to when I was 12 years old and I got Dragon Strike. Do you remember that? It was sort of a board game designed to get people hooked on Dungeons & Dragons, basically. I think it came out in the mid-90s or something. It was a collection of these big dungeon boards and all these little plastic figurines, and it had this terrible video shot in like this. Like primitive rotoscoped deal where it was like they took live action and then they kind of drew over it. But this wasn't like some high quality Linklater shit or something. This was pretty abysmal the way it was done. but I mean, when you're like 13 years old, you're like, oh my God, this is amazing. I'm going to get to explore, it's going to be just like playing one of the Tolkien books or one of the cheap fantasy novels I was reading at the time.
Have you ever seen the Dungeons and Dragons cartoon back in the 90s?
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. Oh my God! But anyway, sorry. Go ahead.
That was equally abysmal. So anyway, I used to play that with my sisters, and then that kind of led into I bought a few more of those sort of a board game-esque starter sets that they had for D&D that had the maps and stuff, and it was still kind of half board game, half role playing game, and then eventually I got into full D&D. Around third edition is when I really started, when I was in high school, and Rudy and I used to play, in the rec room of my house. We had a little D&D group, and played third edition, dabbled a little bit in the other, major traditional games, White Wolf games, and it wasn't until a couple of years ago that I really got into indie games. And Rudy introduced me to the more indie scene. Trying to remember what we played. One of the first games we played was Grey Ranks, actually.
Really? That's a really... Okay. Out of all the indie games, that's a very strange one to start off with, I think, because it's...
Yeah.
It's a different mechanic to the game than traditional.
It was a serious culture shock kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because we had already been... I guess we had been using our D&D campaigns to explore some, like, darker, weirder subject matter, and we really wanted, we thought it was a cool thing. Here's a game that's actually going to try to confront, the realities of Nazi Germany, the horrors of the Holocaust, and all of that, and it's still a role-playing game, and it's designed to do that.
Yep.
So we played that. And then I started reading up on the Jeep Forum website, and I got really into that, and it just kind of snowballed from there, for me anyway.
Cool. And how about Rudy?
Well, for me, it started pretty much with D&D.
Like William said, I was we used to play it at his house in his rec room with a smallish group, usually 3 or 4 people. And then it went from there to I think we actually may have experimented with some White Wolf stuff maybe later.
Experimented, yeah.
Like that Demon the Fallen and Vampire, that kind of stuff. And then we didn't really get into playing indie games until, like you said, Gray Ranks. That was our first deal. And I think I had just bought that just out of curiosity. One day I said, well, hey, you want to run Gray Ranks? And so we ran it, and that kind of got us hooked on some of it. Some of the indie stuff.
What other indie games have you guys played?
Oh, I'm trying to think here.
We have a podcast, Mom's Basement.
I was just going to mention that, yeah.
We play a bunch of games from kind of like up-and-coming indie designers and stuff. And,
a lot of like pseudo-playtesting on the podcast.
Yeah.
Where someone will send us like an alpha draft or something and say... Or we were doing this. The podcast has been kind of on hiatus for the last 6 months or so because we've been working on this. But, you know, Kyle Simon sent us Magicians months before he launched the Kickstarter for that. And so we were one of the first ones to get to play it, and that was an awesome experience. I'm trying to think of some other games that we've received a lot of weird and interesting game submissions on the podcast. Dan Maruschak submitted his game Final Hour of a Storied Age, which is a kind of a weird narrative game that's supposed to mimic epic fantasy. Anyway, a whole bunch of different stuff has been submitted to us, and what we do on the podcast is we would play the game, and we'd record a playtest and send it to the designer, and then we'd critique the game on the podcast. So we've probably got a few dozen episodes of us doing that. Fiasco, we played a number of times. That was a pretty awesome experience. I'm trying to think of other like major indie releases that we dabbled in, but...
Have you tried, Burning Wheel or Dogs in the Vineyard?
That's the big hole in our experience. And, in fact, I had an interview with another podcaster this morning, and this came up with him as well, which is that we played a lot of the really traditional, you know, nuts and bolts, old-school RPGs,
mm-hmm.
D&D, White Wolf, etc. And we played a lot of the more... avant-garde indie crap. Crap in the fondest sense of the term, because I love this stuff, but like Jeep Form stuff and like Gray Ranks and that kind of stuff, the really more narrative stuff. But we haven't played much of the games that straddle that line between mainstream and indie, where maybe they're trying to explore rather mainstream subject matter in an indie way. Games like Gray Ranks. Games like Burning Wheel. I don't know why I said Gray Ranks.
There's another game that Jason Morningstar made, too, that kind of tackled... He put a different spin on it, like you're in space, but it's sort of like the idea of Australia. It's called Durance, yeah.
I haven't played Durance yet. I look forward to getting the opportunity to play it.
And Dog Eat Dog was another one that I was thinking of, too.
Dog Eat Dog is another one. If I had to create like a short list right now of 3 games that I really, really wanted to play but haven't had the opportunity yet, it'd be Durance, Dog Eat Dog, and Microscope.
Microscope's good.
Love to get the opportunity to play, but just haven't yet.
Sweet, okay.
Yeah, definitely check out Microscope, too.
Awesome. Let's go back to your project, guys. Right now you guys got a Kickstarter set up, and it's the Misery Index. It's actually labeled, interestingly, the Misery Index, Terrible Games About Terrible Realities. So why don't you tell us a bit about the index of games that you guys have on your site? And why did you choose that name, like, particularly?
The Misery Index or Misery Tourism Games?
Both, I guess.
So the misery tourism thing. Misery tourism has been used as a slur for, I don't know, at least a few years. on RPGNet, on the RPG site, on a lot of these RPG discussion forums, as you know, as a way to describe, with, you know, obvious negative connotations, these indie games like Grey Reigns or Nicotine Girls or, you know, whatever, that explore, you know, the darker realities of human life, I guess you might say.
Mm-hmm.
Games that explore the ugly side of existence. And you know, the implication there is, well, why would anyone want to experience this? You know, it comes very much from the mindset that RPGs are designed to provide escapist experiences, to provide an out from real life, you know, and from the ugliness of real life, and it should stay that way. And we knew right away with the type of games that we were going to be designing that this was a criticism that was going to be leveled on us. So, you know, we said, why don't we just own it?
Yeah.
Be a little ironic or subversive or however you want to do it. Be a little tongue-in-cheek about it. Just let's own that title and let's make the most of it.
Cool.
The title of the book actually was Rudy's idea, and I thought it was an awesome one, but maybe Rudy can weigh in on that.
Well, yeah, I just figured since we already had Misery in the name, and the Misery Index, from what I understand, is something from economics.
Yeah, it's an economic indicator.
Yeah, that basically it's like all the unemployment. Well, it's the unemployment rate plus the inflation rate or something. Is that what it is?
It's that or the unemployment rate times the inflation rate. It's some kind of mathematical formula that involves
right.
the unemployment rate and the yes, rate of inflation.
Okay, but when I saw that, I basically thought, well, that's a pretty interesting thing that exists. You know, it's kind of like the anti-life equation, sort of. But no, I mean, I just thought that that would go well with the book and, you know, the stuff, especially with some of the games like Welfare Queens. You know, it's directly about that.
Mm-hmm.
And of course. Index sounds like a book. You know, that's the play on words there. The Misery Index is an economic indicator, but an index, you know, it also sounds very literary. It sounds like something that could be a book, especially a book that has, you know, multiple entries in it. And, of course, the acronym is now TMI, which I think is very...
That's awesome. Cool. So tell me about the game. Like the games, I guess, because you said there's multiples, right?
Yeah, there's 8 games in the collection. 4 games, 4 games that I developed, 4 games that Rudy developed. Although all of the games in the collection have been play tested and revised as a group, so it's not like I took 4 of my games and threw them at 4 of Rudy's games. But there is a lot of interplay there, a lot of back and forth. We spent a lot of time critiquing each other's games and. Rudy has inspired a lot of the games in my collection, and I'm sure I've inspired bits of his games as well. So it is a real creative partnership, but within that partnership, we've each contributed 4 games to the collection. My 4 games are 6-page manual, Welfare Queens, Passing, and Dance Macabre. And Rudy's are The Needs of the Few, The Oldest Gorilla's Sword, Mentors, and Student Zombies. And I'm not sure how you want us to... it would take a while to give you a spiel for each and every game, but I'm not sure how you want to break that down.
Okay, well, how about this? Let's take probably the one that you consider to be... are all the mechanics for each one in particular all different?
Yes. Every game is mechanically independent. And the mechanics are... pretty weird. They've all been playtested pretty thoroughly, but they're pretty experimental. The only game that comes close to having like standard character sheet style die rolling mechanics is Welfare Queens, and there's still a twist on that within it. Otherwise, we've got games that use chess mechanics, a game that uses a kind of battleship style hidden board mechanic. We've got a game that uses Pictionary mechanic, a lot of improv acting stuff, some GP stuff. There's even a game in there that's loosely inspired by musical chairs. So it's all over the place mechanically.
So are these are any of these like party games, or are they more so set for like an actual? I mean, obviously it's going to be a misery party, but but you know, like, is there something that you could probably say, I'll have a couple of my friends over and we'll play one of these 8 games?
Sure. Tonally, there's a real variety here. You've got some games that are pretty dark and that probably aren't like a good game to play while you're, you know, you're kicking back with your friends, beer and pretzels, D&D night or whatever. Passing the needs of the few, probably the oldest, coolest sword would all fall into that category. But there are some pretty light-hearted games in this collection. A 6-page manual, for example, is a straight-up party game. It's kind of a Whose Line Is It Anyway meets Jeep Farm game.
How about, what inspires you to create these games? I mean, I know that you guys played a lot of games that are related to hardships of realities, and even some games that sort of put a twist on it as regards to making it a fantasy game by implementing harsh realities upon it. But what inspired you to come up with your own, like, series of games that relate to that topic?
I think these are the kind of things that fascinate me in other mediums. Basically, these games are kind of like the kind of things I like to watch or read when I turn on the TV or pick up a book. You know, I'm not really, as a kid, I was kind of a fan of, you know, escapist high fantasy stuff, but I lost that around the time I went to college and got more interested in material that deals with some of the uglier realities of human life. And yet I never lost that interest in genre stuff, though. And I was always kind of disappointed that there wasn't more stuff that was at the intersection of genre material like sci-fi, fantasy, horror, and social realities. You know, a great example of this in film is something like District 9, which I think really hits the sweet spot between being an exciting science fiction film and yet dealing in a very sophisticated way with the realities of apartheid and on a larger scale racism and classism and stuff like that. And so those kind of things always interested me. And I don't think that there's much of that. There is certainly some of that going on in role-playing games, definitely, but I think there could be more of it. So most of my inspiration is coming from that space.
And Rudy?
Yeah, I think it's pretty much the same for me. William mentioned District 9. That movie was really the first time I saw, like, a Hollywood-type movie, you know, that mixed genre with, at least a science fiction movie. It mixed genre stuff with, you know, like a social issue in a way that I thought was really cool.
Yeah, that worked.
Mm-hmm. It worked really well. And, I've been inspired by that. But also, I mean, basically just reading things and seeing things on the internet. I mean, even on, like, Tumblr or, you know, wherever.
Wikipedia.
You know, just reading things and thinking, hey, that would make a pretty cool game, you know, or I could mix that with something, or I could, you know, mix it up with something genre, and that would be pretty cool.
Yeah, juxtaposition is a big part of these games. Taking one thing and mixing it with another thing to come up with something that isn't just a hodgepodge, but that has something to say about both of the ingredients. You know, I think, for example, Rudy's game Student Zombie has a lot to say both about, you know, what's going on with school shootings, why do kids do this, and also I think it says a lot about what it is psychologically that is behind the appeal of these zombie apocalypse films. What it is that drives people to create, it drives kids really, or teenagers, to commit these acts of school violence, and also what drives us to this media, to this, to these programs, to these movies, to these books about a few lone people against a subhuman horde, you know? So there's a lot of that there. There's a lot of juxtaposition there, and there's a real desire to take different things that fascinate us and mix them together in a way that says more about both than just a cursory glance at them would.
So the games themselves, do they come off with a subtle twist, or are they like directly into the actual? Like, when you're talking about school shootings, are you talking about like you play as students in during a school shooting, or is it more of like a different subtle mechanic, like you're playing as like a hero amongst like a group?
Well, in Student Zombie, it's actually a little bit of both, I guess. In that Student Zombie, basically the premise is that there's an attempted school shooting that's interrupted by a zombie outbreak. And so the shooter is actually, you know, get there at the point where the zombie outbreak is happening and going on. Mm. So, were you going to say something?
Oh, no. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. I think I may be lagging a little bit here. But basically, they've already got guns. They're already loaded up with ammo. So they decide, you know, that, hey, you know, we can still have some fun here. And in the process of that, there is some people there that are, you know, living students who are just regular people who haven't turned into zombies. And so to them, they may actually get to be the heroes, or, you know, get to have some kind of heroic stand, you know, in the zombie outbreak. So I guess in that way, you are playing school shooters, and the intro to the game sets that up, where, you know, you're being interrogated by the police and that kind of stuff. But there's that element of, you know, zombie apocalypse heroism going on there, too.
And I think what it's kind of about is the way that these shooters imagine themselves. I think a lot of them go into these situations. I think in order to commit an act like that, something has to go on. You have to make, when you're a kid, when you're a teenager, in order to go out and murder other teenagers, I think you have to make some kind of internal calculation that these people are not human. You know, that they're not human in the same way that I'm human. And that because of that, I've got some kind of right to act in this way. And I think that zombie horror works in much the same way, you know. It's that idea of there's something within us that wants to be able to hurt other human beings without repercussions, because we believe, or because we want to make ourselves believe, that they are somehow less human than us. And so the intersection, and so this is about, you know, where, how that happens.
What do you think the outlook would be for, like, supplements and such? Are you already kind of, like, thinking if everything goes well? I mean, including, I didn't really quite look at your bonus material for stretch goals and such yet. I don't know if you've got some in the works in the background or not.
We do. We haven't. We're probably not going to post any of that until we get funded. But, yeah, we are looking at... What we're looking at for our stretch goal material is we'd like to put together a kind of PDF companion to the games that includes games by other designers in a similar vein.
Cool.
Maybe a couple of hacks of the existing games. I have another unique game that I'd like, a unique small game I'd like to pitch in there. And maybe also some articles or interviews or stuff like that. Basically, the idea would be to put together a collection that complements the main collection.
Gotcha. And the for the, some of the books, is there, would you consider, like, out of the 8 books, is there one of each that you guys made that you would consider your main book that you will probably make a supplement to in the future?
First of all, it's going to be published as a single collection, so it won't be 8 separate books. It will be one bigger book that contains all 8 games. As for which ones are likely to be expanded on in the future, I don't know. Rudy, do you want to take that one first?
Well, I think definitely 6-page manual. That's one of Williams. Could probably be expanded, and that, you know, the charts and stuff could be. You can make more charts. I mean,
yes.
So be like a 12-page manual.
Yeah. Exactly. 6-page manual is kind of the improv acting deep form parody, and part of it is that you're rolling character traits off of these tables. You're kind of randomly generating characters and then randomly generating additional character traits as the game goes on. We could definitely release more tables or theme tables for that at some point in the future, possibly. Sorry, Rich, what were you?
I think also passing, there was, we've talked about some different types of scenarios for that one. That's the one with the Deep South gentleman. And the vampire and the black guy who's passing at the white prison. But we've talked about some different scenarios for that one that could possibly come up.
And Rudy has already made a hack of Student Zombie, which will probably likely be included as a stretch goal.
Nice. Right.
Cool. So what has been your biggest obstacle so far trying to bringing the Misery Index to life?
You know, that's a tricky question. There has been a lot of controversy over the course of the last week or so. There's been a lot of back and forth on RPGNet, on Tumblr, on Google+. We've had some people, some great people have been wonderful defenders of our work, and we've had some people who said, whoa, you know, this shit, I'm not going to get near this shit. We've had some very critical responses, which I respect. I mean, you can't deal with subject matter like this without potentially offending or upsetting some people, and I totally get that for some people these games just are not material that they want to play around with, that they want to touch, and that's totally understandable. But I'm not sure if that has been kind of...
Well, that's probably two ways, right? Because either way,
right,
you're getting publicity.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
That's a double-edged sword. It's got people talking about our games. It has people defending our games, and it also has, it's been the source of some sleepless nights, though, because you think about... when you spend a lot of time replying to critical comments and trying to keep a cool head about it, it can be, you know, it can be... kind of exhausting, I guess.
Well, there's a lot of games like that too, right?
Right.
Like, I was thinking about just one that came out last year, which was Monster Hearts. That game had a lot of controversy when it came out too. So I'm thinking about, like, or Dog Eat Dog is another one, right? So, I mean, I don't know. I think that really it's good that people are going in that direction and bringing up that genre that other people probably would just be, you know, scared to do due to naked felicity. So I would take it as stride, you know.
I think we have. I think that more than anything else, I'm just happy that there's a conversation going on at all about our games. It's easy to say, oh, well, I wish they weren't so critical, or, oh, I disagree with the thing this person said entirely, and I think they've got my games all wrong. But the bold-faced reality is they are still talking about something you created, which, considering all of the content that is out there, especially in the indie RPG community, all these designers who have been toiling away on all these different unique games, to have any kind of moment in the spotlight at all, to have people talking about your work at all, let alone to have people arguing about your work, which is an amazing compliment in and of itself. But to have any kind of discussion about your work at all is just really, honestly, it's kind of a blessing. It's amazing. I mean,
Absolutely. I mean, one other author that I know that loves controversy with everything he does is D. Vincent Baker. Like, if you look at all of his works, all of them are even, he even has, you know, a game called Kill Puppies for Satan.
Kill Puppies for Satan.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah. Yeah, I could totally see where, you know, being controversial is actually, could be a positive note as well. So.
Right, and of course, Poison, the infamous pirate rape game.
Oh, Poisoned? Yeah.
Yeah, as people present. I mean, there's a lot more to the game than that, but that's the way that it's kind of been spun, right? So, I've got a lot of respect for Vincent Baker and his work. I think it's kind of amazing if you think about it that someone whose work is so controversial on the surface has also had such a huge impact on the indie community. I mean, how many hacks of Apocalypse World exist?
Oh, hundreds.
Dozens of published ones and hundreds of unpublished ones. And to think that came out, and Apocalypse World in and of itself deals with some fairly ugly, controversial subject matter.
Absolutely. All right. So, sorry, Rudy, you never got a whole lot to say so far. Did you have any comments into that you want to say?
Well, yeah. I mean, I have a lot of respect for Vincent Baker as well. And even though I haven't really gotten to play many of his games, we did, I think, for the podcast, play an Apocalypse World hack. And I own Apocalypse World. I haven't gotten to play it yet, but I would like the chance to get into that, because that was basically like something right up my alley.
Right.
as far as that, and Poison, I also own and haven't gotten the chance to play that. But it's definitely nice to be among giants like that. You know, as far as the controversy. Controversial, we're both kind of making controversial works.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. And as far as, you know, what we've encountered as far as problems, I mean, as William mentioned, the controversy, I guess, is kind of double-edged sword and that kind of stuff, but really most of the real work we've had to do is really just narrowing down, publishing stuff, you know, to make the book that we want, to make, you know, to get the actual book itself right. And that's been, you know, kind of, that's been probably our biggest challenge, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
So, like, are you guys getting it, like, you guys printing and shipping yourself, or are you guys, like, are you going to go through a third party for all this? I mean, it sounds like a lot of work.
We are going to be printing and shipping the book ourselves. I mean, obviously, we don't have a printing press in the basement. We're going through. We've got quotes from a few printers. The thing is, we want to do a very specific type of book, kind of a big 11 by 11 square book that we've designed to allow people to play the game inside, to play some of the games inside of the book, to really use the book as an instrument and play. So it's going to be a little. We have gotten quotes from. I think we're ultimately probably going to go through a local printer here in Manchester, New Hampshire, where I'm located. But it is going to cost a little bit more per unit than it would if we went through some, one of the, print as you...
Print on demand.
Thank you. No problem. If we went through a print on demand, some big online print on demand outfit, but we couldn't find a print on demand outfit that would really be able to produce the book we wanted to produce, and that's part of the reason why the book level is $35 instead of say $25. It's because we had to factor those extra costs into it.
Other than the Misery Index games that you have, do you have any other games in mind? If, let's just say, all right, 2 years in the future, you've had a very successful Kickstarter. Everything's been taken care of with the books, and now you're starting a new project. Have any ideas what you already have in the works right now?
I know what I would love to see, and it's not one of my projects, it's one of Rudy's. Rudy has a superhero-themed RPG that uses fairy chess mechanics. By fairy chess, I mean chess with unique moves. It's just a really fascinating, awesome game, and I hope that at some point he gets his shit together here and publishes that, because I've played it a number of times, and it's really an awesome, awesome game.
All right, cool. Is there, okay, well, how about this? So now you guys are getting into the Kickstarter. You guys told me your biggest obstacles and whatnot. Now, if let's say somebody else is out there and they just designed a game, and they want to go the same route, do you have any suggestions that you guys would give to them for starting out?
Rudy, I'll give you the first crack on this one. So kind of monopolizing the interview.
Well, I would say just start off small, just playtest it with your friends, make sure the mechanics and that stuff are solid. And then once you really have your idea down, just post for some feedback on, any RPG net or The Forge is gone now, but that was a good place to do it. But, story games, basically anywhere. I can't see anybody else having as much trouble as we did promoting your game, just because of the fact that probably not anybody else is going to, have games that are this, patently offensive and weird and whatever. So I'd say, you can't possibly have as much of a problem as we had promoting the game. So just put it out there. And just put it out as many places as you can, and you'll get something.
And I would say, also, don't be discouraged if you don't get feedback right away. Don't be discouraged if you have trouble finding people who will even read your alpha draft, or finding people who will playtest your game online. I would say, whenever you find a human being who's willing to look at your work with objective, uncritical eyes and give you good feedback. And good feedback is very important, not something that's coming from their own biases or, whatever. But if you can find a human being like that, I don't care what your sexual orientation is, marry them. Lock them down. Because there is nothing more important than having another human being who you can pitch your ideas off of, who will call bullshit bullshit, and who will call a good idea, and who will feed back to you, who will take your good idea and build on it with more good ideas. And I am just unbelievably fortunate to have that in Rudy. And Rudy and I have both been fortunate to have a group of players who will play our work for us, with us, and to know a few people who have been willing to pitch in and help this project get going. Because if it was just us versus the internet, I would have thrown in the towel a long time ago.
All right, cool. So, is there anything else you would like to add? Because I really have no more questions. Or where they can go to? Do you have a website or anything like that?
You do. If you go to miserytourism.com, that's one word, miserytourism.com, you can find links to alpha drafts of all of our games up there. You can take them, play them, read them, do whatever you want to do with them now. You'll also find a link to the Kickstarter right there.
That's very cool. Sweet. All right, guys. Well, it's already taken up like an hour of your time, but it was very interesting, actually. So,
it's great to be able to have a conversation like this. We've done a few of these interviews now, and I've loved every single one of them.
Sweet. All right. Well, I want to thank you guys for coming up on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
Not a problem. And I'll talk to you probably if you guys put out your next works, or if we end up playing one of your games, we'll probably give you some feedback.
Sure. Fantastic. Well, it's great talking to you.
You too. Take care.